a lot of criticisms against this movie, yet simultaneously at the same time, there's just something about this movie that keeps me coming back to it, that keeps me appreciating certain attributes of the film. I think that the film has hints of brilliance in it. I really do. Yet at the same time, it is highly flawed. So it was kind of difficult for me to review this film because I kept having to weigh the scales, whether I wanted to pan the film or whether I really appreciate the film. And, you know, I just keep coming back to this movie. And there's something in this film that is very charming. This movie has magic. This film has charm. This film has a sense of wonder. Yet at the same time, this film has very, very, very poor artistic decisions, in my opinion. So let's get to it. The Phantom Menace. This movie is a very eclectic kind of film. And what I mean by that is that imagine you have a pot of soup or a pot of stew. And in that stew, we have so many different things being contributed to this brew, to this pot of good stew or good soup. We have, you know, we have Akira Kurosawa kind of samurai characters. We have politics. We have childlike humor. We have so many different things going on in this film. Themes regarding symbiosis, themes regarding duality. It's a children's movie, yet at the same time it has sequences that may feel like C-SPAN, you know, boring politics to another kind of, to another type of person. It really is an eclectic kind of film because it just tries to cater to so many demographics, and it succeeds on some fronts and it miserably fails on others. Now, in regards to the opening crawl, one of the main criticisms that I've heard for this film is that the opening crawl was just too much as far as politics and being boring and being confusing and being inadequate as far as setting up the whole plot to this film. Now, I didn't find the opening crawl to be boring, because I didn't have this expectation for it to be like the previous films, meaning the original trilogy. I didn't expect the opening crawl to be this swashbuckling adventure. I kind of initially remember feeling that my expectation was to kind of receive something along the lines of a history lesson. So when I was presented an opening crawl that was reminiscent of almost like the opening paragraph to a history book describing, let's say, the American Revolutionary War or the Civil War of America, I didn't find it off-putting at all. Now, that doesn't mean that I don't have some criticisms in regards to the opening crawl. I feel like certain details could have been more provided, especially in regards to the motivations for the Trade Federation. One thing that really gets me and that I feel should have been included in the opening crawl or just the film in general is that we should have been provided some kind of motivation for the Nemoidians. Why are they listening to Darth Sidious? What have they been promised? I feel like this is really important. So in other words, what's in it for them? And another additional detail that I feel should have been provided in the opening crawl or in the film in general is, why are the Trade Federation opposing the taxation of trade routes? Like, of course they don't want to be taxed because they lose money and it says that they are greedy, but what is the taxation about? Now, if you read the book Cloak of Deception and the book Darth Plagueis, of course it goes in there, but I shouldn't need to read a book to gather all the details. So in those books, basically the Trade Federation is being taxed because they are taking it upon themselves to create their own droid armies and create their own defenses in order to prevent pirating. So
I guess the Trade Federation is being attacked by pirates. They're losing their cargo. So in order to prevent that, they are kind of militarizing themselves. And the Republic wants to tax them for that. And they're upset about that. So they choose the planet Naboo to blockade. Why was the planet Naboo chosen? Obviously, once the film ends and you put two and two together, you see that Naboo was chosen because Palpatine is there. And Palpatine is Sidious. So he was the one really pulling the strings. And we know now that Naboo was chosen because Palpatine, Sidious, is the senator from that planet. And he basically was creating like a false flag operation in order to exploit the situation so that he can become Chancellor of the Republic, which is what happened. And that's who the Phantom Menace is. It's Palpatine. Now, another additional reason that is explained in the book Darth Plagueis as to why Naboo was chosen was because of its precious resources, namely plasma. So this planet Naboo has this precious resource of plasma, and this is why the Trade Federation was motivated to listen to Darth Sidious to choose this planet. And yes, it's explained in the book, but once again, I shouldn't need to read a book to understand the movie. Again, I want to know why the Nemoidians are even listening to Sidious. What have they been promised? Namely, how is blockading Naboo, how is invading Naboo, how is listening to Darth Sidious going to get rid of the taxation of the trade routes? I really feel like that should have been explained. Nevertheless, it doesn't break the film, but it does create a little bit of confusion for some viewers. So, yes, those are my criticisms for the opening crawl. And another criticism that I have is that there is an error in the opening crawl. It literally says two Jedi Knights, but Obi-Wan Kenobi isn't a Jedi Knight yet. He is a Padawan, so there's that as well. Now, in regards to politics being present in this film, I really didn't find that off-putting at all. I appreciated it. I didn't find the political scenes to be boring. Even when I was younger, I found them to be exciting because I appreciated the fact that George Lucas was trying to give this universe a sense of credibility and to go and give me a history lesson. So the political scenes, the scenes in the Senate, those scenes felt exciting to me because I was getting a glimpse into the history of Star Wars. I didn't expect nothing but a swashbuckling adventure. What I wanted was a history lesson. And a lot of people say that the Senate meeting in the later portion of this film was boring and things of that nature. But to me, it was so exciting. I remember being younger and seeing that Senate chamber scene and really feeling engrossed by everything that was going on because it made the universe feel real. Like there's actual politics and meetings taking place in this film. So I wasn't off put by the politics in this film at all. Now, that's not to say that there aren't things in this film that put me off, because they're definitely is, and we will get to that very soon. And I just want to give this analogy in regards to The Phantom Menace right here. This film reminds me a lot of the Beatles album, The White Album. And what I mean by that is that album, The White Album by the Beatles, it is an album that has the Beatles' greatest songs, and at the same time, it has some of the Beatles' worst songs. Songs that should have never even seen the light of day. So a song like Wild Honey Pie, which is just awful, that's like Jar Jar Binks. That idea should have never even have came to fruition. Same thing with Wild Honey Pie. That song should have never been released because it's just awful and an embarrassment. Yet at the same time, you have epic songs like My Guitar Gently Weeps and Dear Prudence. Well, those songs, they're like the Duel of Fates, which is easily the greatest lightsaber duel in the history of Star Wars as far as fight choreography. It's amazing. Maybe it's not the greatest duel as far as emotion, but it is as far as fight choreography. It's just breathtaking to watch that duel. It's beautiful. It's like a dance. I love watching that duel. It has one of the greatest chase scenes or action sequences in the form of the pod race. So things like that, those are some of the greatest moments in Star Wars, and they're being juxtapositioned with some of the worst things of Star Wars, such as Jar Jar Binks. Well, that's why I make that analogy with the Beatles' White Album. And the point is, the film would have been so much better if all that nonsense was cut out of the film. And this is why fan edits such as the Phantom Edit came into existence. Because the film would have been excellent if all that unnecessary stuff was edited out the film. Well, the producer for the White Album, George Martin, who was the main producer for the Beatles, he said so himself, the White Album would have been so much better if it had just been one disc instead of two. If we had just chosen the best tracks, it would have been probably their greatest album, in his opinion. So that's why I make that analogy, because I feel like it's applicable to The Phantom Menace. And even George Lucas himself admits this. There is a quote from George Lucas where he states how he had to use quote-unquote hamburger helper in order to get the movie to be 2 hours. He literally says, "I know I'm going to need to use hamburger helper to get it to 2 hours. But that's what I want to do." So basically, what's he trying to say? I need to put a bunch of filler in order to stretch the film out to be 2 hours because I don't have enough material. I'm going to save the more important stuff for episode 2 and episode 3. Well, I feel it, George. That's exactly how I feel when I watch your movie. When I see Jar Jar Binks going on and on with his stupid antics that aren't funny to me. When I see all this unnecessary exposition with the pod racers being introduced, seeing the aliens selling snacks in the pod racing audience, and just all this unnecessary stuff that it just brings the film down because it just deviates my attention from what is important. It's just unnecessary. And every time I watch this film and I see this long exposition shots, like the taxi scene when the protagonists get to Coruscant and just, "Hey, look, it's Coruscant. Look, I'm going to fly over this building." And it just goes on. And, "Hey, look, let's introduce all the pod racers. Hey, look, there's a guy selling snacks to the audience in the pod racing scene. Hey," it just goes on and on. It's like, why is this here? And this is why the Phantom Edit came into existence, because somebody was able to see, look, this film would have been totally acceptable if you just cut out all the stuff that doesn't need to be in it. You can literally cut out 20 minutes of this film and it would improve it immensely. A whole letter grade, just because it just drags the film down. And that's what George Lucas said himself. He added hamburger helper in order to stretch the film out to 2 hours. And the film suffers for that. It's the pacing that suffers. The pacing gets thrown off. The momentum of the film keeps getting stopped for unnecessary things. Things, I don't mind a film slowing down if we can develop characters and get an emotional connection, but this film slows down for nonsense. And that's the main point. All this nonsense throws the pacing off, throws the momentum of the film off. Luckily, there's magical moments in this film that save it. Now, one of the positives of this film is that The Phantom Menace has the best cinematography out of the entire prequel trilogy, and I attribute that to it being shot on film, whereas Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith were shot in digital. Another thing about this film that I really love is the art direction. This film is beautiful to look at. It's gorgeous. I also feel that The Phantom Menace looks the best out of the prequel trilogy because more real-world locations were utilized when they were shooting the film. It's especially important for me that real sunlight hits the actors. I feel like when you try to recreate sunlight in a digital environment, it looks really fake, and this was really, really evident in Attack of the Clones especially. Also, the digital compositing for Attack of the Clones, I feel like was in its infancy because digital filmmaking was just getting started, and that's why that film looks really bad, but that's a different story. In regards to The Phantom Menace, I really feel like the digital shots are sold better. They look more real because the actors are being in a real world environment. That's real sunlight hitting the actors. The film looks great. The utilization of film also helped a lot because you don't have to worry about digital compositing and things looking fake. So yes, The Phantom Menace is a beautiful film. I love the way this film looks. Now, in regards to the special effects, I feel like a good portion of them still hold up today. The pod race looks amazing. The Duel of Fates looks amazing. Naboo looks amazing. The only thing that looks a little off to me is Jar Jar Binks. But you have to keep in mind, this is almost 25 years ago. And it doesn't even look that bad. I mean, yes, it's clearly evident that Jar Jar is a CGI creature, a CGI character, but it's not terribly bad. It's not like Anaconda bad or the Scorpion King bad. I've seen much worse CGI from the same time period. But for the most part, the film still looks great. The special effects still hold up, especially the pod race. It looks beautiful. And the sound design by Ben Burtt for the pod race, oh, to me, that's the standard. If I ever want to test my home theater sound equipment, that's the movie I put on. And that's the scene that I go to. I go to the pod race, man. Those engines roaring, those sounds, oh, they're the perfect way to optimize your home theater sound system. And just the whole Ben Burtt's creativity in creating these sounds, I mean, he outdid himself. And I come back to it again, The Phantom Menace. It has its issues. It has some really bad things, but it also has some of the best Star Wars things. The best lightsaber duel as far as fight choreography. One of the best action sequences as far as the pod race. The best soundtrack by John Williams. The best sound design, in my opinion, with the pod racing scene. There's a lot of good here, and again, the special effects still look great today. For the most part, one of my favorite things about this film is Liam Neeson. I've always loved Liam Neeson as an actor, from Darkman to Schindler's List to Rob Roy. He's just one of my favorite actors. Loved him as Ra's al Ghul in the Dark Knight trilogy. And him as Qui-Gon Jinn is just, it's a dream come true. Because before this film was released, when I thought of my idealized version of what a Jedi would be, outside of Alec Guinness's betrayal of Obi-Wan Kenobi, I imagined something like Qui-Gon Jinn. And Liam Neeson was the perfect casting for Qui-Gon Jinn. Because in retrospect, Qui-Gon Jinn is the ideal Jedi for me. I love his character. And some of the criticisms that are levied against this film are that this film lacks a true protagonist. But I argue that Qui-Gon Jinn is the main protagonist because he is the one that comes across all the central characters. We follow Qui-Gon Jinn and to a lesser extent Obi-Wan Kenobi through all the events of this film. So for me, Qui-Gon Jinn is the main protagonist in this film, followed by Padme. Now, another criticism against this specific character, Qui-Gon Jinn, is that he comes across as bland. There's not much to him. There's not that many character attributes, but I argue against that. Qui-Gon Jinn is essentially a rogue Jedi. It's explained in the film how he can never really become a member of the Council because he's always in disagreement with the Jedi. yes, one criticism that I do subscribe to is that it's told to us and not really shown. So, and there's that rule in filmmaking where we say, show, don't tell. And I will concede that. However, that is a character trait that we see to a smaller extent. It's kind of subtle. I mean, you see how Qui-Gon Jinn is defiant. He's going to train Anakin anyway, despite the Jedi Council saying no, he will not be trained. So we do see him go against the Jedi, and we do see him talk about the living force versus, I guess you want to say, the unifying force or the cosmic force. So Qui-Gon Jinn, in other words, he values life, and I think that played a central role in how he basically took Jar Jar Binks under his wing, if you want to say, but because all the characters in the film don't like Jar Jar Binks. They don't want nothing to do with him, but Qui-Gon Jinn sees value in him, even if he's reluctant to at first, because when he first comes across Jar Jar Binks, he kind of doesn't want him to be around, tells him to go away, but then he sees value in him, sees that he could be useful, whereas Obi-Wan Kenobi is just like, another pathetic life form, and things of that nature. So Qui-Gon Jinn, he is at odds with the Jedi Council. This is even explained in a deleted scene from Attack of the Clones where Obi-Wan Kenobi talks to the librarian, Jocasta, and the librarian says that Count Dooku can never really agree with the Jedi Council, similar to your master, Qui-Gon Jinn. It's a deleted scene. So, point that I'm trying to make is Qui-Gon Jinn, he's kind of like a rogue Jedi. He does what he believes is right. And the Duel of Fates, the reason why that whole sequence, that lightsaber duel, is called the Duel of Fates, it's because the outcome of this whole story would have been entirely different had Qui-Gon Jinn lived to teach Anakin versus Obi-Wan Kenobi teaching Anakin. Obi-Wan Kenobi was not ready. And I play with that idea, and I think it's fascinating. So the point is, I love Qui-Gon Jinn. I think he's an outstanding character. He's my idealized Jedi next to Alec Guinness as Obi-Wan Kenobi. And I really, really enjoy Liam Neeson. Another interesting thing is that a lot of fans really look at this film, the ones that don't like the movie, as lore breaking, because they like to compare what actually went down in this film with what Obi-Wan Kenobi recollects in the original trilogy. So when Obi-Wan Kenobi recollects Anakin in Return of the Jedi, I'm talking about Return of the Jedi, not A New Hope, because A New Hope got retconned as soon as we found out that Darth Vader was Luke Skywalker's father. So this whole notion that George Lucas had it all plotted out, it's total bullshit. That's not true. Check out my original trilogy reviews, the cinema thesis stuff. Well researched. George Lucas did not have it all planned out. He made it up as he went along. I'm talking about the original trilogy. So point is that whatever Obi-Wan Kenobi's telling Luke in A New Hope doesn't count because it got retconned later on in the original trilogy. So when Obi-Wan Kenobi says that Uncle Owen didn't want Anakin to go with him on some idealistic crusade or something along those lines, that doesn't count. What counts is what happens in Return of the Jedi, what Obi-Wan Kenobi tells Luke in Return of the Jedi. And the point is, he has some kind of romanticized ideal version of his relationship with Anakin, a romanticized version in his memories. And in The Phantom Menace, we see the prequel trilogy in general, we see a very different relationship than the one he recollects in Return of the Jedi. And initially, at first, I kind of felt like this was contradictory, but I kind of see what George Lucas was trying to do here. And it happens, you know, when we're older, we recollect the past and we have a romanticized version of it. And we're not going to really go into deep detail with other people about the negatives. Like, did you really think, I know it's all retcon, the prequels were written after the originals, but even then, do you think that Obi-Wan would really go into detail with Luke Skywalker about the negatives that he had with his father? No, he's just going to recount the positive stuff. But I do like how this whole dynamic between Qui-Gon Jinn and Obi-Wan Kenobi and Qui-Gon dying and basically Obi-Wan Kenobi kind of forcing himself to train Anakin when he wasn't ready. He just took it upon himself because he made a sworn oath to his dying master. It's an interesting dynamic because it shows that Obi-Wan Kenobi, despite the relationship between Anakin and him becoming brotherly later on, he was never meant to be the teacher. And this seed that is planted in this film, this seed that illustrates that Obi-Wan Kenobi was never truly meant to be Anakin's teacher, it shows why there was this rift between them, and this small little rift that eventually became one of the reasons why Anakin turned. I feel like that was fascinating, and I really feel like, you know, there's some credibility here. And I kind of appreciate it in retrospect now. And also, remember when Obi-Wan Kenobi asked Anakin to do something deceitful in Revenge of the Sith to the Chancellor, and we know he's evil. Yeah, he is Sidious, but at the moment, he asked him to do something dishonest, which was against the Jedi Code. That further kind of creates a wider rift between the two, and that piled on top of the fact that they had this relationship, the bickering between them, how Obi-Wan Kenobi really didn't want to train Anakin, and it was only because of a sworn oath to Qui-Gon Jinn that actually went down. I mean, it really shows you the seeds that are planted as to why Anakin fell and why essentially the Jedi played a part in his and why he fell. So the point is, these alleged contradictions between the Phantom Menace and the original trilogy, I really think that there's something there. I really think that there's something beneath the layers that is deep and kind of profound. And despite this film's shortcomings with Jar Jar Binks and other things that I'm going to get into, I've come to appreciate this. I've come to appreciate it. And I no longer look at it as this contradiction because it used to bother me. I used to be like, oh man, it makes no sense. Qui-Gon Jinn, Obi-Wan Kenobi's the one that's supposed to discover Anakin. And he took it upon himself to train Anakin because he saw he was a strong force user. He says this in Return of the Jedi. And now when I look at the bigger picture, I see like, well, you know, this story that's been laid down by the prequels, it's interesting because there's some subtleties in there as far as the complexities of relationships and the character dynamics and the motivations. And it shows that a character like Obi-Wan Kenobi, he's not perfect, right? And, you know, I can appreciate the storytelling that George Lucas attempted. But coming back to Qui-Gon Jinn and Liam Neeson's acting and portrayal of the character, it's because of Liam Neeson that this film survived all its shortcomings. It's because of Liam Neeson that this film can overcome its challenges and all the issues. It's because of Liam Neeson that I can get over Jar Jar Binks and all the unnecessary exposition and some of the poor blocking and the shot compositions and things like that. It's just that Liam Neeson is such an outstanding actor, and this character, Qui-Gon Jinn, is such a strong character. He's the perfect Jedi, and again, it's because of him that I love this film. And another attribute of Qui-Gon Jinn that I love is that he plays a father-like figure to not only Obi-Wan Kenobi, but also to Anakin especially. And I really think the dynamic between Anakin and Qui-Gon Jinn is well executed. the relationship between Jake Lloyd, the actor that plays young Anakin, and Liam Neeson is great. They have chemistry. I really feel like there's a father-son type of relationship right here. So not only is Qui-Gon Jinn a rogue, is he rebellious, but he's also a father-like figure. And he's also stoic and humble. So he does have these character traits. And for the critics to say that he's a boring, bland character, I just don't subscribe to that at all. And Qui-Gon Jinn's appreciation for the living force really illustrates one of the central themes in this film, which is symbiosis. So there's this theme of symbiosis, how life forms have to get along with one another, how we basically rely upon one another, whether we're conscious or aware of it or not. We need each other. So you have the midichlorians, which have a symbiotic relationship with all the living things. And then you have the symbiotic relationship between the Naboo and the Gungans. And yes, I really feel like that's just a great message that this film possesses. And Qui-Gon Jinn is one of the characters at the forefront pushing this message. Like when that's one of the first things he tells Obi-Wan Kenobi, to be mindful of the living force. And this is also shown in how he values even the most quote-unquote pathetic life form. He sees value in Jar Jar Binks. And ultimately what happens is because of Jar Jar Binks that our protagonists are even able to have a victory at the end. Because it's because of Jar Jar Binks that the Naboo and the Gungans were able to make peace, unite, and fight against the Trade Federation. So again, there's great themes in this film, and I really appreciate them. Also, this value of the living force that Qui-Gon Jinn possesses, it contrasts so strongly with the attitudes that the Jedi Council have. I mean, think back to how the Jedi Council reacted to Anakin. They didn't want anything to do with him. When Qui-Gon Jinn recommends training him, they basically scoff at him, they roll their eyes, and they kind of send the message like it's just a big waste of time. They don't see the value in Anakin, and Qui-Gon Jinn does. And this really illustrates how far the Jedi have fallen. And of course, this is one of the reasons why the Jedi collapsed and they were all killed, and why the rise of the Empire happened, and why Sidious was able to take advantage. It was because the Jedi became too structured in their ways. They overlooked the value of the living force. They became so orthodox and so dogmatic that they forgot about the living force. So Qui-Gon Jinn really plays a pivotal role in this contrast between him and the Jedi Council. And this contrast is vital to the Star Wars saga because, again, it illustrates how they had a huge, huge hand in why Anakin fell. They were way, way, way too blinded by structure, orthodoxy, and their dogmatic nature that they forgot the true value of the Force, the living Force. The notion of compassion that is exemplified by Qui-Gon Jinn is also really important here, because Qui-Gon Jinn even says to Shmi, "I didn't come here to free slaves." But ultimately, what ends up happening, his compassion, he starts to go beyond the duties that he is basically there for. He takes it upon himself to try and free Anakin. And he would have freed Shmi too if he could. As far as how that plot point is written, we'll get into that later. But as far as what George Lucas was trying to execute, Qui-Gon Jinn went out of the parameters of his duties. He was supposed to focus on saving the queen. And he comes across this boy who's strong in the Force and his mother, and he wants to free them because of compassion. And this is really important to the saga, because ultimately what saves the galaxy? Luke Skywalker's compassion for his father. even against the instruction of Obi-Wan Kenobi and Yoda. So down to the, basically even the last moment, Obi-Wan and Yoda were saying, you have to kill your father. You got to go against your father. You have to defeat your father. What does Luke say? I can't kill my father. Luke has compassion. And ultimately, this compassion is what helps Vader kill the Emperor, because he starts to feel that as well. Compassion for his son. So he refuses to allow the Emperor to kill his son, and he ends up destroying the Emperor. And I think it's a beautiful story. And I think this compassion is at the heart of this saga. And I really feel like Qui-Gon Jinn was the seed of this idea. It was subtle, but it's there. And that's one of the great things that I love about George Lucas. I mean, he has these themes. They're subtle in there. And we could talk about how bad George Lucas's dialogue is, or some of the execution, but you can't just dismiss George, because he has some brilliant ideas. He really does. And I think he does know what he's doing for the most part when it comes to some of this stuff. It's subtle. It's in there. It's layered. And it's really interesting, because this is a children's movie, right, on the surface. But it's a political thriller, really, is what it is. It's a political thriller disguised as a children's movie. And I love how, in the end of this film, it's the bad guy that wins. On the surface, it looks like the good guys win. You got John Williams's happy soundtrack playing. And really, it's the bad guys that win in this film, because Palpatine becomes the Chancellor. Yet, on the surface, it looks like this great victory. Our heroes won. And when you see the saga, and then you come back to this film, you really look at it through different eyes. And every time I see the ending to this film and how it looks like one big happy ending, I'm just there like, wow, Palpatine really played them all. So, yeah, George Lucas, he does have some subtleties in his writing. And he, and for, you know, people love to complain about his dialogue and things of that nature. And we'll get into that later. But you cannot just dismiss George Lucas. He does have some skill when it comes to storytelling. That's my point. Now, in regards to how this film is shot, let's talk about George Lucas's directing as far as compositions. George Lucas loves to be expedient when he sets up his shots. So you got a lot of wide shots, not a whole lot of close-ups and things of that nature. There's a lot of wide shots. Why? Because he can get all the characters in there, so he doesn't have to do multiple takes. And you know, it's kind of boring. It's not really that exciting, his directing. Yet at the same time, I've seen worse. It's very, very, very mediocre, his shot compositions. He really does struggle, especially in this film, with blocking. Meaning, he doesn't give the characters a lot to do, the way the characters associate with their environment, the way they move in their environment. There's a lot of standing around and talking, sitting around and talking. And he doesn't give his actors business to do. He doesn't give them much to do as far as physically for some of these dialogue scenes. And I'll give you two good examples of this. One is when Anakin basically warns Qui-Gon Jinn and Padme of the sandstorm that's coming, right? When that scene opens up, Qui-Gon Jinn, it's weird. Like, they're at some kind of stand where that old lady's there, and it's like they're contemplating on buying something from her. But when the scene opens up, Qui-Gon Jinn is just, he's just standing there, staring off into God knows what. We don't even see what he's staring at. And he's just standing there, and it just seems like, what the hell? What's going on here? Like, why wasn't he given something to do? As an actor, like, It's like you could have easily like had Qui-Gon Jinn fussing around with whatever that woman was selling him, looking at it, and then set up the scene and have little Jake Lloyd say, "Hey, sandstorms coming. They're very dangerous. You could come to my place." Oh, okay. But instead, the scene opens up and Qui-Gon Jinn is just staring into space. And every time I see that, I'm like, what the hell is he supposed to be looking at? Another example, and it's kind of the same thing. When our protagonist returned to Naboo, right before Jar Jar Binks unites the Naboo with the Gungans and makes peace between them so they could go up against the Trade Federation at the capital, Theed. Right when that scene opens up, where the ship lands and we're going to get introduced back to the protagonist, Qui-Gon Jinn is just, again, staring off into God knows what. We don't even see what he's looking at. If he's staring off at the scenery or at the mountain range, show that to us. Let's see what he's looking at. But instead, the scene opens up and Qui-Gon Jinn is there with his hands on his hips and he's just kind of just staring off into nothing. And then Obi-Wan Kenobi comes up and it's like, "Hey, I'm sorry. It's not my position to say that you shouldn't train the boy, et cetera, et cetera." But again, it's like George Lucas, these are really, 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 for lack of a better term, amateurish mistakes. These are the kind of mistakes that a newbie does in your local community college cinema class. Not someone like George Lucas, who made the original trilogy, who made THX 1138 and American Graffiti. So to see that, it's like, what the hell? Like, what is going on here? Like, give these characters something to do. So yeah, blocking and the lack of business for the characters is a big problem for this film. I want to say it's a bigger problem than Jar Jar Binks, because again, this is super amateurish like mistakes and it doesn't really look good. I don't know why George Lucas decided not to plan this stuff. And I really think it's because he values expediency. I really don't think he's trying to make some cinematic masterpiece. He's just trying to get it done. And I think this is the problem when you have essentially the CEO of a company also making the movie. So he's also like the chief executive officer or the owner of Lucasfilm. He's the producer of the film, the financier of the film, and the director. So I feel like, yes, he wants to just get the movie done. Whereas if you were to hire a director, they're just in charge of directing. So they have all the energy, or they have the capacity to think about cinema, making something artistic, going out of their way to come up with some good blocking, to come up with some good business for the characters. So that's just my conclusion on some of the mediocre directorial decisions for this film. It's because George Lucas values expediency over making some good cinema. And just really quick, for those that don't know what blocking is, okay, when you block a scene, it just means that you are working out the details of an actor's moves in relation to the camera. You could think of blocking as the choreography of a dance or a ballet, but an application to this film or to acting, right? It's all the elements on the set. The actors, the extras, the vehicles, the crew, the equipment, and how they should move in harmony with one another. So this film lacks blocking because it just seems like everybody just stands there or sits down. So yeah, that's one of the major issues with the prequel trilogy, especially this film. But right now I want to share something more on a positive note. So I know a lot of people were very disappointed when this film came out because of just how the tone is so different than the original trilogy, and just because it's super different than the original trilogy. Now, for me, Sure, there were some disappointing things in regards to this film. However, there was some things that were literally like a dream come true for me. So, prior to the release of The Phantom Menace, all we had as far as a glimpse into how the Star Wars galaxy was before the original trilogy was the comic book series Tales of the Jedi. And this is Dark Horse comic stuff. And we had a little bit of other stuff as far as like the Bantam era novels. And they had some little subtle things such as details in regards to how things were prior to the prequel trilogy. But when it comes to Tales of the Jedi, that was it. So Tales of the Jedi shows how the Sith and the Jedi were at war with each other thousands of years before The Phantom Menace. And there were some great stories. It really went into the lore of the Jedi and the Sith, the conflict that existed. So when I go and see Phantom Menace and I see this epic duel between Obi-Wan, Qui-Gon, and Darth Maul, the duel of fates, that to me was like a dream come true to see that in a live action film, because I've only read it in the comics. And to see that on the screen, it was just mind blowing. I was so thankful. Despite Jar Jar Binks and all the other issues, that right there was just worth the price of the ticket alone, worth the price of admission alone. It was like seeing those epic lightsaber duels from the Tales of the Jedi comics come to life. Darth Maul was amazing and a really, really important part of Star Wars history, and that is really misunderstood, is that the first double-bladed lightsaber made its debut in the Tales of the Jedi comic books by the Sith known as Exar Kun, who is also the villain in the Jedi Academy trilogy. So a lot of people presume that Darth Maul was the first one to debut the double-bladed lightsaber. Yeah, sure, in a live-action film, but before Darth Maul, it was Exar Kun that he was the one that debuted the double-bladed lightsaber. So to see Darth Maul wield that was another amazing thing as a fan of the Tales of the Jedi comics. It was just amazing. So this whole perspective that The Phantom Menace was just a total bust, it was just a complete and utter disappointment, I never subscribed to that. There was plenty to love in this film. And that being said, even people that love those Bantam era books and love those Dark Horse comics, they were still disappointed ultimately because of some contradictions in the story. But for me, I always knew that George Lucas was going to have his own canon. He was going to do his own thing. He wasn't going to have to abide by what the EU authors were going to do. That would just totally tie him down creatively. So there were people that were upset because the Jedi can't have families. And in the novel, the Bantam era novel, Children of the Jedi, it stated that the Jedi had families, they had children. Other differences, such as the clones fighting against the Jedi, not alongside them. I mean, hey, those EU authors had a lot of freedom to write what they wanted to write, but to expect George Lucas to have to abide what they laid down, I just feel like that is not realistic, because George Lucas, he's the ultimate authority in the Star Wars galaxy at this time. So he was going to do his own thing. So I wasn't one of those passionate EU fans that was disappointed by The Phantom Menace because of some of the contradictions in the canon. And that's because I always knew George Lucas has his own canon. And the EU is a different canon. And if it can line up to George's canon, then that's great. If not, well, I'll still take it. It's all fiction. So I don't get wrapped up in this whole canon obsession that some Star Wars fans have. Now, in regards to some additional negative criticisms, what I'm about to talk about right here, I'm very passionate about, because There are numerous shortcomings in this film, many things that I have to criticize. However, one of them that I hear from other people, I just passionately disagree with and I think is outright despicable. And what I'm talking about is that there's racist caricatures in this film, or that somehow George Lucas is a racist because of Jar Jar Binks and Watto and things like that in the Nemoidians. Now, let's talk about Jar Jar Binks. First of all, George Lucas is married to a black woman. He has a biracial child with her. Second of all, the actual actor that plays Jar Jar Binks is a black man. And he came up with a lot of the mannerisms on his own free will. George Lucas gave him the creative freedom to come up with this character, to flesh out the certain attributes and characteristics of this character. No one put a gun to Ahmad Best's head and said, "You got to act like this because I want to depict African Americans or black folks in this racist manner. So do whatever I say." Yeah, it's just stupid. Stupid. I don't know if it's people virtue signaling or people who just are ignorant as to how the making of Jar Jar Binks, the character, went down. But 100% fact, no, this is not a racist depiction of black people whatsoever. And if you think that, I accuse you of racism because you're the one that sees that and says, that's how black people act. And I just think it's ridiculous. Again, Ahmad Best, no one put a gun to his head and said, act like this. He came up with this character with George Lucas, but a lot of the mannerisms, he came up with it himself. And you know, all the negative criticism, all these ridiculous accusations of racism and all these cruel, mean-spirited accusations against this character, who I don't like Jar Jar Binks. I'm not saying that I like him. I'm just saying to go that route is just despicable. And those kind of accusations and that kind of like excessive negative criticism that just has no merit is why the actor Ahmad Best considered killing himself. I mean, can you imagine how that feels, being a black man and being accused of participating in a racist depiction of your own people, when this whole time you're having this great time making this film on the set of Phantom Menace, you think you're making something special and magical, and all of a sudden the critics are just saying like, yeah, your character's racist towards your own people. Yeah, so all you virtue signaling idiots that print that crap, yeah, you almost contributed to the death of a black man, the type of people that you claim to be defending. So congratulations, you're a fucking idiot and a scumbag.
Another thing that I really enjoy about this film, I love seeing Darth Sidious and the Emperor again. I love that connection to the original trilogy. It's nice to see a familiar face. This film is entirely plot-driven and not story-driven. Now, they're not the same thing, even though many people think they are, but there is a huge difference between story and plot. Now, plot focuses on the information of the story. It's the actual arc of the story. Not the character arc, but the arc. It's the plot. It's what's going on. We go to point A to point B. The chicken crossed the road. That's the plot. Now, the story is, the chicken is crossing the road, and while he's crossing the road, he's thinking about how his wife divorced him, and he's thinking about how this is going to trouble his life and all the challenges he's going to face, and how he won't be able to achieve his dream to travel to Fiji, which he's always longed to do since he was a little boy. See, that's story driven. Story is about character. Plot is about the details, the logic behind the story. And that's one big issue that episode 1 and 2 have, is that they don't focus on story. They don't focus on character. And that's why so many people love the original trilogy, because it's story-driven, it's character-driven. Whereas the prequel trilogy, at least the first two films, are plot-driven. It's about information. Episode 1 and 2 is about information. This is how Emperor Palpatine became the Chancellor. You know what I mean? This is how the clones were made. That's what it is. That's what those movies are about. They're not about Qui-Gon Jinn's dreams. They're not about Qui-Gon Jinn's feelings about everything that's going on. We don't know very much about how he feels about things. It's only subtly revealed to us through little nuances. But if you look at the original trilogy, you see Luke's dreams. You empathize with him. He longs to get off that damn planet, Tatooine, and join in the adventures with his friends, and join the Rebel Alliance. And you see even Rey, you see her struggling. She has these moments alone. You don't really have many moments where you see the main character by themselves reflecting on something profound. Especially Phantom Menace and Attack of the Clones. Like, there's not one moment that I can remember where Anakin had alone time in Attack of the Clones. But that's a different story. But again, I think that much of the confusion as to whether there was a main character in this film or not is because of that. It's because these films are plot-driven. Phantom Menace is plot-driven. It's not story-driven. It's two different things. It's not character-driven. And that's one of the weaknesses of this film. However, Liam Neeson is such a great actor, has such a great screen presence. You know, he has such star power that he's able to pull it off for me. You know, I love his character. I love Liam Neeson. You know, it may be a plot-driven film. However, he carries the film through his charisma, you know. And I really feel like Liam Neeson was sorely missed in Attack of the Clones because of that. You know, it was hard to for those three main characters, Ewan McGregor, Hayden Christensen, and Natalie Portman, to carry the audience through a plot-driven film, you know what I mean? Because I don't know if it was the screenplay, but, you know, they just didn't have that screen presence as much as, say, Alec Guinness did, you know, or Qui-Gon Jinn did. There's something about a veteran actor with charisma that could really save your movie. Harrison Ford did the same thing in Force Awakens. And one thing that I noticed about this film that I found very fascinating, and I really feel like I said earlier that this film has a level of intelligence that's not present in the other Star Wars films, or just like a subtle meaning. There's something deep going on despite the troubles with tone in this movie, and that's the themes of duality and symbiosis. You know, I love how there's a duality. There's the duality between Sidious and Senator Palpatine. You know, there's two different versions of those characters. And also simultaneously, there's the duality between Padme and Queen Amidala. You know, they're split into two different characters, yet they're the same person. Duality. Same thing with the Emperor. You have Palpatine and Sidious. Same person, two different characters. Very fascinating thing. And then you have the theme of symbiosis, which is, you know, you have how the Naboo and the Gungans are reliant upon one another. You know, there's a symbiotic relationship that one cannot function without the other. And then this is also seen in the midichlorians, how the mitochondria that live within the cells of humans act as a conduit for the Force. We need them and they need us. You know, the microorganisms, it's like if you look under a microscope into the cells in your body, it's almost like there's a whole civilization living inside of you. And also simultaneously, we pulled up. We took the Hubble telescope and look at Earth. We're nothing but a speck of dust. We're literally just another speck of dust. We are literally just ants. We are. If I live in a city, that city is like my own little personal mitochondria. So we could go infinitely small and infinitely large. symbiosis. It's just very interesting themes in this film that are not present in the other films. The other films have more emotional themes and themes that resonate with us in regards to mythology, in regards to coming of age, in regards to rites of passage, and things like that. But this film has a more cerebral approach, I want to say, in its themes. And it's very fascinating to me, despite all this film's glaring errors and mistakes. Now, there are also other examples of symbiosis in this film that I like to discuss just briefly. Now, we've talked about symbiosis in regards to the Gungans and the Nabooans, and we've talked about symbiosis as far as the midichlorians, but there's also a symbiosis between the Jedi and the Republic, for better or worse, but it exists. And there's also a symbiosis between the Trade Federation and the goals of the Sith. And just, you know, this may be a little subtle kind of thing, or maybe even just a minor nuance, a little detail, but just look at the twin suns right there. There's two. You could look at that as another example of duality. And I think it's a nice, beautiful addition to the theme of symbiosis and duality. I thought that the opening sequence with the lightsaber battle between the droid was so exciting when I first saw it. I mean, you've never seen anything like this before in your life. I mean, you have to imagine a time before the prequels existed. All we had was the original trilogy. And to see that opening scene where Qui-Gon Jinn, you know, and Obi-Wan Kenobi, you fight those droids, you finally get to see the Jedi in their prime. It was so outstanding. And the scene where Qui-Gon Jinn plunges his lightsaber into the door and then it starts to melt, I remember being blown away by that. I mean, it's because I never thought of it. I never seen anything like that, you know. And then we had John Williams' outstanding soundtrack. Arguably, John Williams' best soundtrack for the Star Wars films is Phantom Menace. And, you know, the music's playing, Qui-Gon Jinn's lightsaber is in that door, it's melting off, John Williams' music is cueing, and it's such an emotionally charged moment because it's just magic. It's just pure magic. Never seen anything like it before, and I really appreciate it. I thought it was really cool, too, to see another new and novel Force power. And what I'm talking about there is the way Qui-Gon Jinn and Obi-Wan Kenobi used that super speed ability to run away from the droids, the destroyer droids. That was so cool. Again, never seen anything like that before. It was a magical moment, you know. So I don't know why people just completely lambast this movie, you know, like there's nothing good with it. Because I remember seeing that scene in the theater and being like, oh my God, I've dreamt about this. You know what I mean? And it's like, we're actually seeing it, you know, and having Liam Neeson be there. I'm telling you, Liam Neeson is one of the best Jedi ever. Qui-Gon Jinn, man. And I love Natalie Portman's makeup when she's Queen Amidala. Again, outstanding art direction, beautiful sets, beautiful designs. The costume designer should have won an Academy Award. I mean, it's just gorgeous to look at. The Phantom Menace is the most beautiful out of all the prequel films. It's truly, visually, a work of art. Some people thought that Natalie Portman's portrayal of the Queen and Padme was wooden. But I found her to be stoic, and I found her to be humble, and I found her to be a great character. You know, I said previously that some people expect her to be, what, emotional, but instead she's not emotional. She's not in a panic. She's trying to hold it all together. You know what I'm saying? And again, she's humble for her age. And one thing that I think that has to be addressed is where George Lucas got his inspiration for the depiction of this character, and I'm referring to Kabuki theater. So you have females in these old Kabuki theaters, actresses, female characters from Kabuki theater, and you look at the way they're portrayed, and you can totally see where George Lucas got his inspiration for Queen Amidala. And the way that the criticisms have been levied against this character are pathetic and just show a lack of film knowledge. from these critics. I mean, they immediately just, oh, she's boring, she has no personality, get out of my face. That's the kind of attitude. But when you step back and you really study the layers of George Lucas's filmmaking in regards to The Phantom Menace, you can see that he draws inspiration from so many resources in film history, in cinema history. And Queen Amidala comes from Kabuki theater. These characters are not in hysterics. These characters aren't running around hysterical. These characters are not emotional. You know, they're very conservative in the way they're presented. And that's why Amidala was directed the way she was directed. You know, it wasn't a failure in directing. It wasn't George Lucas failing to achieve something. The constant criticism is, oh, George Lucas is not good with actors. That may be for other instances, but in this instance, when it comes to Queen Amidala, he did his job impeccably because she's totally like an actress from old Kabuki theater. I feel like she's emotionally reserved, but I felt like she had to, because she had to be perceived as a woman who has her shit together. You know, she's the youngest queen ever voted to the position, and I don't think I want to see her freaking out left and right. Natalie Portman acted beyond her years. She was playing the role that she needed to play, which was a young woman who is a teenager with a huge amount of responsibility that's usually given to an adult woman. And I feel like she was acting like that. She wasn't acting like a little teenager. She was acting like a leader. And you don't want to see your leader cry and freak out, you know, show us emotion. How come she's so wooden? Well, she has her shit together, man. She's trying to be calm, you know, before she puts the people of her planet at a jeopardized risk, man. And I thought the criticisms about her being wooden are unfounded. And I think people wanted to see characters like the original trilogy, you know, where you had a bunch of like a young ragtag group of rebels. But this is a different age. This is an age of courtship. This is an age of knights. Like, everything feels more courtly and stoic and humble and noble. That's the word I'm thinking about. It just feels like a time of nobility. So I feel like when people say that the characters are wooden, I feel like the main reason why they make that accusation is because of that nobility attribute that's present during these times, the times of the Old Republic. And I just want to say something about Captain Panaka, who I thought was a great character and is so underrated and often too much. He's often just forgotten, man, and I think it's sad, man, because I thought he was a great character. I wish he had been present in the other two prequel films. I really appreciated his character, and I would have loved to see more of him. He's another prime example, and I made this, I also said this in the A New Hope and Empire Strikes Back, I think. How everybody's all up in arms that the new sequels are so diverse. They're so diverse. But dude, what are you talking about, man? You know, like, oh, Finn, he's a black character. Oh my God, let's all applaud, guys. Like, dude, black people have been present in Star Wars from day one. James Earl Jones, Darth Vader, Billy Dee Williams, Lando, Captain Panaka. You know what I'm saying? Mace Windu, Samuel Jackson. So it's like, shut the hell up. It's like Star Wars has always been diverse. And point being, Captain Panaka is so underrated. We need to talk more about him, or at least I wish there was more stories about him. I really found him to be an interesting character. I've also heard some accusations that people think that the Qui-Gon Jinn's plan to sneak aboard the two separate ships and land on the planet of Naboo was absurd, because how is he going to know that they would land on the same spot at the same place? Well, I think it was fair to say that they knew that they were going to go for the capital, you know what I mean? And that they were all going for the queen. So I think it was a safe assumption that both those transports would land at the same designation, because they're trying to invade Theed, which is the capital of Naboo. So I think that's a nitpick, and I don't agree with that claim. Okay, now, let's talk about Jar Jar Binks. Now, Jar Jar Binks was a mistake. Jar Jar Binks is a character that gets its inspiration from two things. And one is Buster Keaton, and the other is the Fool from the old mythological tales or old tales, like let's say King Lear or something. So Jar Jar is the Fool and he's Buster Keaton essentially. And we know that George Lucas likes to borrow from old school films and get his ideas from films and TV shows that he grew up with and mythologies and books that he read when he was young. So I'm pretty sure that he got, you know, Jar Jar Binks from Buster Keaton films and King Lear or something like that, you know, the Fool. Now, the role that Jar Jar Binks plays in this film is pretty good. However, its execution is just maddening. And when I say Jar Jar's role is pretty good, I mean the initial idea that you have an outsider who has been rejected by his people actually turns out to be the unifying force between two divisive people, and that being the Gungans and the Nabooans, or whatever, the people of Naboo. You know, because of Jar Jar, they were able to come together and form a coalition and be able to fight against the droid army. You know, I get it. It's a good idea. However, the execution is just not good at all. Jar Jar Binks was way over the top. He had one joke too many, and his voice was just not pleasant. His voice is aversive to my ears. I mean, it has nothing to do with Ahmad Best's voice, but it has to do with just the accentuation and how he performed the voice. I mean, think about it. What's more pleasant to the ears? A voice that sounds like mine, or a voice that sounds like this? High pitch and annoying! You know what I mean? So it's like, it doesn't even matter what Jar Jar says. Just hearing his voice makes the hair on your neck stand up, man. Bad choice right there. Bad choice to deliver Jar Jar's voice like that. Second bad choice with Jar Jar. Making his speech intelligible. Just giving him that awful speech impediment. I mean, the Gungan king, I can understand him fine. That other Gungan general that initially arrested Jar Jar, I can understand him fine. But for some reason, Jar Jar talks like he's mentally ill. You know, why? I don't understand. Still to this day, I have no idea what the fuck this guy is trying to say 50% of the time. Like in that sequence when they're underwater and Jar Jar is in the little sea boat, you know, or the little submarine, and Qui-Gon or Obi-Wan says something about the Force, and then Jar Jar goes, "Oh, Maxie used the Force. That Force stink with." I'm like, "What the fuck is this guy? What is he talking about?" You know what I mean? It's like, why are you having him say these things that are going to be unintelligible and undecipherable to the audience? You know, if Jar Jar is there for humor, give him a good joke to tell. Give him something that I can understand. He's saying all this unintelligible stuff, man. And then another example is when Anakin and Jar Jar get in the transport and they're going to the Senate building or to the quarters, you know. And then when Anakin gets in the shuttle, Jar Jar says something like, "Misa pretty hot, huh?" or something like that. And I'm like, what the fuck is he talking about? What is he talking about? Why is he saying this? Why is he saying this? I mean, if you want to make a funny character, give him a good joke. Write a good joke. You know what I mean? And deliver it, man. But it's like, Jesus, man, I don't understand what he's saying. Why would you want to make the dialogue of your comedian or your comedy relief unintelligible and undecipherable and not be able to understand it? It's like, it's just poor artistic decision right there. Just tremendous Bad choice, man. That was such a bad choice. And I also feel that Jar Jar Binks had one joke too many. You had to cut that down by 50%. You know, a perfect example here. You know, when Qui-Gon, Obi-Wan, and Jar Jar are leaving the underwater city, you know, to go to Theed, the capital of Naboo, and they're on that little submarine, they use the same joke twice. And that's the giant fish. There's always a bigger fish. First, Jar Jar freaks out. They get bitten by a big fish that bites their submarine. Jar Jar freaks out, and then Qui-Gon goes, there's always a bigger fish. Then we cut to the Nemoidians, and then we come back, and what happens? Again, the submarine loses power, and they come across a big giant fish that starts chasing them. And what happens again? Jar Jar freaks out. And it totally kills the momentum of the film. We had a great and wondrous start. Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan having their little battle when they tried to negotiate with the Nemoidians and then got double-crossed. Magical moments, seeing lightsaber stuff we never seen before, seeing Jedi tricks we never seen before. And then we come down to the planet and it all comes to a screeching halt when we get to these Jar Jar antics. Again, Jar Jar Binks had one joke too many. And the tone of the film is totally thrown off because of that. And that's the main thing, the second main thing. The first thing that I had a problem with in regards to this film was the blocking. Second is the tone. The tone of this film is all over the place. Now, I think George Lucas wanted to cater to all the demographics of the world, right? But I think he forgot one thing, and that's that Star Wars has always appealed to general audiences. That's why people love Star Wars. I think that's why the original trilogy was so successful, because it reached the young, the middle-aged, and the old. And I think Jar Jar Binks is a mistake because it's baby humor. It's toddler humor. It's literally caca, poo poo, pee pee. I mean, when Jar Jar Binks goes back to his underwater city, I mean, the guard that catches him goes, "You in big poo poo now," or something like that. Like, "You in big doo doo." And then Jar Jar slips in poo and he's like, "Ooh, icky, icky poo." And then, you know, and then that horse, that space horse, farts in his face and he goes, "Ooh, poo pee, you some poo poo," or something like that. Dude, it's like, oh my God, man. Why, George? Why? You totally throw the tone off with that because you are catering to a demographic that is way too young, in my opinion. You are catering to 2-year-olds, 3-year-olds. You know what I mean? That's the kind of audience that would find that kind of stuff funny. But it's a mistake because that demographic is already in love with this film because they love what? They love the Jedi. They love the pod race. They love, you know, the Duel of Fates. They love Darth Maul. Those little kids are already going to be buying your product, man, because they love that stuff. You know, you don't need to resort to gags in order to cater to that audience. And that's something that Irving Kishner did with Empire Strikes Back, because when he was directing Empire Strikes Back, he said something that I wish George Lucas would have subscribed to, and that was that he knew that the film had to have comedy, but he couldn't rely on gags, you know, and that's what Jar Jar Binks is. He's reliant upon gags. He falls, you know, he slips, he hits his head, you know, it's not wit. It's not witty dialogue like the humor between Han and Leia in Empire Strikes Back. It's not clever dialogue like it was between C-3PO and R2-D2. You know what I mean? Like, that stuff was like punchline comedy kind of stuff. You know, it relied upon timing and cleverness of the dialogue. Whereas the comedy with Jar Jar Binks is gimmicks. It's gags. And I understand that Buster Keaton is a legend. Buster Keaton is a legend. However, when placed into its proper context, Buster Keaton is a legend because he's a human. He's a human being. You know what I mean? It's a human being falling off a train and hitting his head. You know what I'm saying? On something. You know what I mean? So you watch it and you're like, oh shit. You know what I'm saying? Whereas this, it feels like, you know, like a Roger Rabbit cartoon. So when it comes to Jar Jar, he was a huge mistake. I'm not against Jar Jar Binks as far as his character, the purpose of his character. I thought that was great to unite Gungans and Naboo together. I just thought the execution was awful. He probably had like, what, 20 little gags in this movie? I feel like he only needed 5, you know? So that's how I feel about Jar Jar. Definitely brings this film down, you know, a couple of notches. However, I still stick by my initial statement that this film has a lot of good in it, and it has more good than bad. So now that we've talked about Jar Jar and got that out of the way, let's move on. And I love the underground city of the Gungans. It was like watching Atlantis or something like that. When I first saw that, I was blown away. I've never seen anything like that before, you know, just the visualization of it. And then killing that with John Williams' mystical, dreamy-like score. I mean, it was amazing. You know, I when I first saw it, I was really, like, amazed. I was blown away. I was like, whoa! We've never seen special effects like that before. So a lot of the younger folks that are into Star Wars, they're spoiled by all the special effects. But if you grew up seeing the technological advancement of special effects, when you saw these special effects in Phantom Menace, you were blown away. Whether you thought the story was mediocre or not, the special effects were state of the art at their time. And I'm glad that I was able to appreciate it like that, because I can't look at it in any other way. Phantom Menace will always be special to me because of that. You know, I thought that the Gungan boss, Nos character, I thought he was interesting. He kind of reminded me of a Disney character, almost like something out of Lion King or something like that, you know. I thought he was pretty interesting. You know, he had like a toad-like appearance going on, and like he did like this little toad-like thing with his chin and the drooling, you know. That may have been a little bit weird to some people, but you know, I thought it was amusing. It was no big deal to me. And one last thing I want to mention in regards to these underwater scenes, and again, the mention of there always being a bigger fish further emphasizes on the theme of symbiosis in this film. Another critique about Jar Jar Binks is the animation. The physics behind the Jar Jar Binks animation is way too cartoonish. I feel he acts too much like a Looney Tune character, and I wish they would have animated him to be more like an organic being or a real organic creature in real life. How a real creature in our world would behave in regards to abiding by the laws of physics. Because Jar Jar is slipping and falling like he's Bugs Bunny, man. And it just cheapens the universe and it takes me out the picture. And again, it ruins the tone of this movie. I love that shot of the invading Trade Federation airships, you know, and seeing Padme staring out the window inside that big palace in Italy, seeing that beautiful and just mind-blowingly unique dress with the little lights around the bottom of it. I mean, everything is just so artistically beautiful in this film. Jar Jar Binks or not, man, I could just look at this film all day. I like that a lot of the scenes were shot on location, like in Italy and Tanzania, and you can really tell that the characters are outside and not on a studio lot in front of some green or blue screen. You know, and I really appreciate that, and I feel like it really makes a huge and significant difference here. Now, the whole sign the treaty plot point was very boring, and I feel like it needed to be elaborated on. If signing the treaty is so important, why didn't the Trade Federation just make a forgery? I don't understand why treaties are still being signed. With what? A piece of paper and a pen? In the Star Wars universe? When they have devices and contraptions that are highly sophisticated, like lightsabers and such? I mean, I don't know, they don't really elaborate that the signing of the treaty is with a pen and paper. Maybe it's done on an iPad or something. But it just feels a little, I don't know, it just feels a little dubious or fallacious that, you know, that the whole, that this whole conflict is based on signing something. Like, I'm down with the invasion. I'm down with the reason why they're there. They're against taxation of trade routes.
I'm down with that. But the way that George Lucas wants to create a sense of urgency. Oh, you gotta sign the paper or you're gonna die or they're gonna kill you. It's just like, maybe instead of signing something, it could have been something a little bit more concrete as far as Padme had to do it and only she could do it. Only Queen Amidala could do it. Only Padme could do it. It had to be her. Maybe if he elaborated that the signature is not necessarily a signature, but maybe some kind of thumbprint or a drop of her blood to confirm the DNA that it's really her. When you kind of make it ambiguous and just leave it out there like, oh, she has to sign the treaty, it's just kind of like, oh, really? I mean, it just makes you think, well, why don't the Nemoidians, the Trade Federation, just forge that shit and be done with it? I don't really think that there's that many plot holes in this film, but I do think that certain plot points could have been fleshed out a lot better, and this is one of them. I wanted to know more about how this treaty is to be signed, and if it is indeed a signature, because if it is, that's ridiculous. And it would have been nice to know what the Nemoidians were promised by Sidious, and it would have been nice to know why the Nemoidians were being targeted for taxation. Instead, we have to read a book. We gotta read Cloak of Deception. We gotta read Darth Plagueis for further details. And this is the biggest problem that every Star Wars film has had since the original trilogy, for the most part. Maybe not all of them, but I want to say 80% of them, there's always some kind of plot detail that needs to be read from a book in order to make you appreciate the film more, and that just brings the film down, because those plot details need to be in the movie. And another thing that I really want to criticize here, and that's how kind of easy it was for that single Naboo cruiser to escape the blockade. I know that they tried to build some kind of tension there and suspense with the hyperdrive leaking and, you know, the shields being down, and now they're sitting ducks, so to speak, like Captain Panaka said. But nevertheless, though, it just felt a little too easy still that one single ship was able to pass the blockade. I mean, just the fact that they attempted to leave the blockade in the first place kind of ruined the whole suspense of there being a blockade to begin with. What I would have rather seen is maybe the proposal, let's get in the ship and get out of here, and then them say, oh, but there's a blockade, there's no way we can escape. And then, like, have a moment where, like, well, these are our choices. We could stay here and get slaughtered, or we can risk our lives with a 50% chance of getting killed and trying to dodge the bombardment from the lasers in order to escape this blockade. And then our characters have to make a choice. So that way, when they actually escape the blockade, it doesn't feel so kind of cheap. I mean, even though they tried to create a little bit of tension, it didn't really work for me, even though I appreciate that opportunity to introduce R2-D2, which I thought was great. I thought it was adorable. I just felt like there could have been a little emphasization on making that blockade feel a little bit more deadly. And that's one criticism I have about that aspect of the film. Okay, now let's talk about the great, the almighty, the awesome Darth Maul. Oh my God, how I would kill for just one more scene with Darth Maul in this film. Darth Maul is an outstanding character to me. You know, I love the fact that he doesn't talk much. I love the fact that he has a presence in the film that's there even when he's not on screen. You feel like he's looming over the events. However, I feel that a couple of additional scenes of seeing Darth Maul doing some hunting, doing some questioning, doing some cutthroat interrogations, you know, in order to find the Queen, and in order to find the Jedi, would have been much appreciated. I would have loved to seen Darth Maul like interrogate somebody or question somebody, like come up to him and be like, have you seen this woman? Have you seen this girl? Have you seen this these people, you know, and show a picture of like Qui-Gon and maybe Queen Amidala to, you know, a local person on Tatooine, and the guy's like scared out of his mind, and then he's like, no, I don't know who that is, and then Darth Maul just, wah, he just like cuts his throat. It would have just made Darth's presence a greater threat. And I felt like it would have contributed to his presence throughout the film, even though he's not on screen. And I feel like a great example of a film doing this is Jude Law's character in Road to Perdition. Now, Jude Law is probably in that film for less than 20 minutes, but he plays an assassin. You know, similar to Darth Maul's role in this film. He's a hired assassin, and he's looking for Tom Hanks' character. And he's hunting him. He's not in the film that much, but when he's on there, you know that he's a deadly threat. And when we do see Jude Law up to no good, it portrays him as a twisted and morbid character. And I feel like Darth Maul could have benefited from something like that immensely. Another great example is Heath Ledger's Joker in Dark Knight. Now, if you trip about it, Heath Ledger's not in that movie front and center. You know, not like Jack Nicholson was in Batman. For the most part, the Joker kind of wades in and out throughout that movie. You see him now, now you see him, now you don't. See him now, now you don't. You see him now, now you don't. He wades in and out throughout that movie. Sometimes we have, you know, significant periods of time where we don't see his story or see him, you know, but we know he's up to no good behind the scenes. You could feel his presence throughout the movie. His presence is felt throughout the movie just like Jack Nicholson was in the first Batman. The only difference is that Heath Ledger's on the screen less, and that's because his character is written to like loom over the events that are happening. And it would have been nice to see, instead of Darth Maul sending probe droids, you know, out into Tatooine during the pod race in order to find Qui-Gon Jinn, it would have been better if he had gone hunting for himself. I would have loved to see Darth Maul ride into town on his bike, get off the bike and go inside a bar and be like, have you seen these people? Maybe somebody thought that they were tough shit and stood up to Darth Maul, and you would have had a cool little scuffle. And again, it would have just contributed more to the character. But nevertheless, Darth Maul is a great character. Wish we had more of him. Just his presence. Not necessarily dialogue. I kind of like the fact that he doesn't say much. At least in this film, we know in the Clone Wars that he's voiced by an outstanding actor, and we know that he has a lot to say, and he's a great character. However, for this film, he had a Darth Maul vibe. I mean, not a Darth Maul. He had a Boba Fett vibe to him. Let's not forget the double-bladed lightsaber, which was taken from Tales of the Jedi. Exar Kun was a Sith from the Tales of the Jedi, and he was also the villain in the Jedi Academy trilogy. And basically, he was the first one to have a double lightsaber. That was the first time anyone had ever seen a double-bladed lightsaber, right? In the Tales of the Jedi comics. Exar Kun, right? Then we got to see it in live action. Darth Maul, for the first time. So the first live action depiction of the double-bladed lightsaber was in this film, and it was great. It was great to see it on screen for the first time. So many people were blown away by that, me included. I thought it was a magical moment. This film, despite all its glaring flaws, has some real magical stuff into it. And again, I feel like the good outweighs the bad in this film, and Darth Maul is one of those good things. The Duel of Fates, I'll be talking about that later, but just right now I could say, hands down, the greatest, one of the greatest lightsaber battles ever. Maybe top three, top two, but it's definitely a contender and it's definitely arguable. You can't shut someone down that says the Duel of Fates is the best lightsaber battle ever. You better consider that opinion. Now, there's two main portions in this film that really slow it down, and the first being the whole setup to this pod race, or rather the setup to the bet, it just drags on, and there's so much exposition that's unnecessary. What we need to do is set up this race, right? Our heroes land on this planet, they go into the shop looking for parts for the hyperdrive, they encounter a special boy. They gotta go to this boy's house, find his backstory, find out he's gifted, work in collaboration with this kid in order to win the money in this race so they could buy the parts to get off that planet, right? It's a lot of stuff, right? Therefore, we don't need more Jar Jar jokes. We don't need to meet all of Anakin's friends. We don't need to be introduced to every single pod racer. We don't need to see every single flag that represents every single racer in this race. We don't need to see the alien in the stands with the audience selling peanuts to the crowd. We don't need to see Jabba the Hutt. Way too much exposition in this film, and it totally throws the tone off of this film. And I said before, that's the greatest weakness of this film. The throwing off of the tone. The tone of this film is all over the place. The tone and the blocking are the two worst things about this film. That whole setup to the bet, it was just, when you add all that unnecessary exposition, and when you add all the double crossing and all that, it just slows the film down. And I remember when I saw the film in the theater, after all that excitement that was built up in the opening sequence, the first act, I started squirming in my seat, man. I was just like kind of squirming in my seat during these Tatooine scenes. It wasn't until we got to the pod race where I got reeled back into the magic. So it was great that that pod race was right there in the middle of the film after all that boring exposition. And it was also great that George Lucas decided to make it one super long action sequence, man, because it made you feel rewarded for sitting through all that exposition that was unnecessary. Now, in regards to the exposition in this film, the excessive exposition in this film, George Lucas, it's clear to me when I watched the whole prequel trilogy, it's clear to me that George Lucas only had enough material for 1.5 movies. Obviously, 80% of that material ended up in Revenge of the Sith, and I feel like the other 20% that he had remaining, he just stretched it out into two other films. And these are his words. He says this himself. He confirms what I just said himself. And there's a quote out there of George Lucas saying that he had to use quote-unquote hamburger helper in order to complete the first two episodes of the trilogy, and that Revenge of the Sith was indeed the film or that had the most story material that he initially wrote down for the prequels. And I feel like Phantom Menace, it is so significant in that film that there is so much quote-unquote hamburger helper in that film. All that bullshit introducing all the pod racers, every single one, introducing all their flags, seeing all the aliens in the stands buying peanuts and selling popcorn, seeing all of Anakin's friends make, all that stuff is unnecessary. It could have been cut off this film. This film, you could have chopped off 20 minutes from this film and it wouldn't have hurt the movie at all. It would have actually improved it, because it would have improved on the tone and the pacing of the film. So yes, the exposition on this film is too much and it slows the film down immensely. Specifically in the scenes with building up this bet against for the pod race, and the second section of this film is figuring out how the queen is going to get her palace back. How she's going to win back Theed. That whole setup in the forest. Getting the Gungans to cooperate with them. What are they going to do? What's going to be the plan? It just dragged on forever. And I'll talk about that later. Now, let's talk about Watto. I think Watto is a great character. He's inspired from Ben-Hur. A character in Ben-Hur. The slave owner. And as a matter of fact, he looks exactly like the slave owner. It's so clear that they
depicted his image when they created this character. Because if you put the actor side by side with Watto, there is a definite relation there. And how do I know that it's Ben-Hur? Because the chariot race is inspired by Ben-Hur as well. And I love how George Lucas borrows from classic films and classic TV shows. And Ben-Hur is one of my favorite movies of all time. I think it's like in my top three. I love Ben-Hur. And I love the fact that George Lucas borrowed from that film. Watto is a sniveling little weasel. I love how he always has himself and his best interests. He's always up to no good, always trying to swindle out the next man. Yeah, great character for me. I love the voice acting from that character. I enjoy his interactions with Qui-Gon Jinn and how they try to backstab each other, you know, and be sly. And again, I think this is a great moment to pick out, to show and point out Qui-Gon's rebellious behavior when Qui-Gon uses the Force to trick the dice into rolling into his favor. That could be, you know, arguably, that could be perceived as abusing the Force. Would a Jedi do that? And that's why I love Qui-Gon, because Qui-Gon, he's like the father figure, yet he's willing to do what it takes in order to get the results that he needs. Much in line with the way Anakin turned out. And you can see in this film when Obi-Wan, you know, questions him on some of his choices, primarily the sequences on Coruscant, you can see the contrast in styles. And it's great how it foreshadows the contrasting between Anakin and Obi-Wan. Obi-Wan and Anakin are similar to the contrast between Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan, especially in that scene when Obi-Wan questions his methods and questions him going against the Jedi Council, saying that Anakin is dangerous. And it's only because Qui-Gon Jinn's last dying wish was to train the boy that Obi-Wan took up that, you know, took up the mantle and said, "I'll train the boy." It's only because of Qui-Gon's last dying wish that he did so. And some people out there think that that's a contradiction to the events that are accounted by Obi-Wan in Return of the Jedi, because in Return of the Jedi, Obi-Wan says, "I took it upon myself to train him as a Jedi Knight, and I thought I could train him just as well as Yoda, but I was wrong." Of course, George Lucas did not have Episode 1 in mind when he wrote Return of the Jedi, but I don't think that it contradicts it, only because, I mean, you could call it me filling in the gaps, you know, whatever. But I like to think that Obi-Wan thought the best for Anakin after he got to know him. I like to believe that Obi-Wan considered Anakin as a dear friend, you know. And just because he said, "I took it upon myself to train him," that's still a dying wish, and fulfilling that dying wish still is, I took it, you know, it's still a taking that you have to take up that role, that dying wish. And I wouldn't expect Obi-Wan to go into like, "Oh, and Qui-Gon Jinn and blah blah blah," you know what I mean? It's like everything has to be within the context of its own film. That little aspect or difference between Phantom Menace and Return of the Jedi never really bothered me. Him saying that I thought I could instruct them as good as Yoda, I was wrong. Well, you know, that may be, you may have a point in case there, because there never was that exchange between Obi-Wan and Yoda. Yoda wasn't like, "Oh, let me train him." And then Obi-Wan was like, "Oh no, I could teach him just as good as you, master." Now, in regards to continuity again, it's very, very much a mixed bag, because we could sit here and say George Lucas messed up in regards to what Obi-Wan tells Luke in Return of the Jedi. Was he really impressed with how much the Force was within him, you know, etc.? Did he really take it upon himself to train? It's a mixed bag, but I will give him the benefit of the doubt in regards to the one scene where Obi-Wan looks up Anakin's midichlorian count, and he is impressed. He's like, "Wow, even Master Yoda doesn't have a midichlorian count that high." So he is impressed. So we can, you know, you could take that scene and apply it to Return of the Jedi when old Obi-Wan says, "I was impressed with how strong the Force was with him."
Sure, but you can't deny the fact that later on he says, don't tell me we've picked up another pathetic life form, and that later on in the film, two times does he say, the boy is dangerous, we shouldn't train him. So much so that Qui-Gon even had to snap at him and say, hey, that's enough of you, dude, get out of here. And then later on they had to reconcile that moment. And why? It was because Obi-Wan Kenobi, he didn't think Anakin was worth training. I mean, and again, does Obi-Wan want to tell Anakin's son this? Does he need to know this all then and there in Return of the Jedi? You know, maybe not, but still. I mean, I feel like it could have been depicted a lot better in order to match continuity. It's not a complete failure, but at the same time, it's not even a moderate success at all.
And another thing I like to talk about is Jake Lloyd. I thought Jake Lloyd did an outstanding job. I love his gee whiz attitude. And, you know, I think he's such a sweet, innocent little guy. And I think he did a great job with the material he was given. And I think the way he's been treated is just terrible. I mean, people are criticizing this child actor like he should have been Robert De Niro in Raging Bull or something. You know, I think it's despicable the way that people made fun of this kid, you know, and I think people took it way too far and what they thought Darth Vader should be as a child. I like the contrasting of Darth Vader being depicted as an innocent boy. It shows that no one is born evil. Anyone can make a turn for the bad. You know, and I just think that it brings a whole new level, a whole new layer of meaning and significance to the Star Wars saga. And yeah, Jake Lloyd did such a great job. He just has that perfect attitude for a Buck Rogers kind of a serial. He brought a level of innocence to the film. And you know, when you see Jake Lloyd, Anakin Skywalker, in that pod, that essentially is George Lucas. You know, every time I see that scene of Jake Lloyd in that pod during that race, it brings a smile to my face, man, because I know that that's George Lucas's inner child right there. I know George Lucas has a fondness for, you know, racing, you know, hot rods, as evident in American Graffiti. I love to think that that is all our inner child. And that's why Star Wars appeals to the inner child in its all. You know what I mean? It's such a great feeling seeing young little 9-year-old Anakin being able to do all that in his pod. And I thought it was great to not have him have a lot of dialogue. He was a quiet, focused young boy. I think that the pod was a great way to depict his Jedi powers without getting too super powerish. It was a great way to show Anakin's uniqueness and how special he is in the universe. Having him be the only human that could race the pod in the galaxy was great. Again, love it. Love the thought that that's George Lucas in that, little George Lucas, man, in that pod. Great imagination, such a great vision. When I see things like the pod race in Star Wars, I can't help but be so grateful, you know, because you are never going to see creativity like that ever again. Star Wars is in Disney's hands now, and whether you hate or love the prequels, regardless, George Lucas's brilliant, unique ideas, you'll never see stuff like that ever again, you know. Strapping two airplane engines on a pod and just having, you know, 9-year-old Anakin race through the valleys of Tatooine. Such brilliance, such uniqueness. You don't see imagination like that anymore. Sequences like that to the Duel of Fates. You're never going to see anything this dope ever again. Forget about it. Every action sequence, everything you see in these Disney Star Wars will be borrowed from what George Lucas already did. And that's what made the original 6 films so special. And I also said in the Force Awakens review how initially I had mixed feelings for that film, and that was because we've come to a ceiling effect with the special effects. How far can special effects evolve to impress us? But when the original 6 films were coming out, George Lucas was pushing that envelope. How far can we go
with the special effects. How far can we go with my ideas and getting them on screen? And he pushed it and he pushed it and he pushed it. And if you grew up seeing them in succession to one another as they came out, you were just blown away by how much special effects would advance in the years between. It would just jump. I walked into Phantom Menace, just blown away. And then when I walked into Attack of Clones, blown away. And then Revenge of the Sith, it's like, oh my God. Each one, each release for me, the special effects blew me away. And again, you will never see that ever again because Disney's priority is not to push the envelope. Their priority is to play it safe and generate revenue. So, George Lucas, you are gravely missed. Now, in regards to the dialogue, it's serviceable. It's nothing special. But at the same time, it's nothing too ridiculous for me. I feel like, at least for this film, the screenplay, you know, people say, it's terrible! To me, I can't think of anything as bad that's, or at least as awful that's at least present in Attack of the Clones. Compared to that, this film doesn't really have anything in regards of dialogue that really bothers me. I feel like there's worse dialogues in some of the other Star Wars film. It's not the most exciting dialogue, you know. I'll give you that. But at the same time, you know, I feel like this film gets bashed a little bit too much. Especially when comparing to, like, the sequel trilogy or something. Anakin is a messiah-type character born without a father. You know, divine conception. I think George Lucas definitely got his inspiration from mythology, from Jesus, from Horus, you know, from world religions. And if you ever see his original drafts of the original trilogy, the Journal of Wills is something that's written in there, and in the Journal of Wills, it speaks of the prophecy of the twin sun. So, the prophecy of the person that will bring balance to the Force was an idea that he had since before the first film even came out. So, you know, I don't think that's something that I'd be upset with or have a point of contention with, because I like that idea. People say that Anakin is like space Jesus. I think that George Lucas has brought a level of uniqueness to his, at least in regards to his spin on that tale. And I think that it's a very unique story because it's about balance. And Anakin isn't like Jesus, man. You know what I'm saying? Because we all know that he falls. And he has a completely, entirely different story than Jesus or Horus. So I think George Lucas just borrowed a little bit from mythology and religion, you know, and he came up with something brilliant in this regard. And again, I think it's beautiful that Anakin started out as a sweet, innocent boy, and then he turned into, you know, one of the most terrible people in the galaxy. It just brings a level of deepness to it that wasn't present before. Another thing that drags this little sequence down, and I'm talking about specifically the scenes on Tatooine, is the phone calls that occur back and forth between Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon. It was just so tedious, and again, it slows the movie down. I mean, I feel like there's like a dozen different conversations that take place between Obi-Wan and then Qui-Gon and then Obi-Wan and Panaka and then Qui-Gon and Panaka and then just a phone call here, a phone call there. And again, the blocking is boring. The characters are doing nothing. It's like they just stand around all day waiting for the phone to ring or to make a phone call. Again, George Lucas's greatest weakness in this film is blocking and just not setting the tone. Not keeping the same tone throughout the entire film. It's just bonkers and it goes all over the place. You know, people say his dialogue is his greatest weakness, but to me, no. At least not in this film. Like, no way. The dialogue is serviceable. Here, to me, the thing that bothers me the most is the blocking. The blocking and the poor tone. When Anakin brings two strangers to his home, two things here. One, I wish Anakin's depiction of being a slave would have been just a little bit more gritty and a little bit more cruel. Because when the Jedi Council evaluate Anakin's potential in being a Jedi. They say, oh, he has too much fear in him. But for me, they say he has too much fear in him, but I'm like, I don't see no fear. I haven't seen him get mad. I haven't seen him do anything bad. As far as I'm concerned, he's a sweet little kid. Like, what the hell's up with these Jedi saying that he has fear in him? What, because he misses his bomb? Like, come on, there's got to be more to it than that. But apparently there isn't. And I think it would have been great, and that this film would have benefited so much if we had got to see, like, maybe Watto abuse Anakin a little bit. Maybe he hits him for making a mistake in the shop. Maybe instead of having, you know, all these great friends, you know, on some Leave It to Beaver shit, maybe instead he has no friends. Maybe he's dirty instead of being all well kept up and having a nice cozy cot. Maybe he lives in a little slum and he's dirty and filthy, you know, almost like the slums, some of the slums in India from like Slumdog Millionaire or something. I feel like that what it made me feel like, yes, this young boy, has the potential to have some bitterness in life, to have a little bit of apprehension to him, you know what I'm saying? But instead, it's presented to us like, you know, Anakin's a sweet little boy, even though he's a slave. Isn't he a great kid? You know, and it's just like, and then you get to the Jedi Council, and they're like, no, this kid is, man, I sent something bad with him. And I'm like, what? Like, as far as I'm concerned, like, everything we've seen about this kid is just, you know, he's just a sweet little guy, you know what I'm saying? Like, what do you mean he's dangerous? What do you mean he's full of fear? I haven't seen that. That movie could have benefited so much if those scenes were just directed differently. Just directed to emphasize on the life of a slave. So, instead, we come home to this nice cozy little house that looks, it almost looks like a TV show, like Full House is about to unfold. The way that Anakin just nonchalantly brings, what, four strangers into his home. And his mom is just like, oh, hi, want some dinner? You know, it's just like, dude, that scene was just so bad. That was just so bad. That was just directed so poorly. Maybe not directed as far as like what he wanted, but just it was just conceptualized so poorly. And I would want to see like Anakin bring home four strangers and at least have a little exchange between his mother and young Anakin. Like, who are you? Like, Anakin, you can't be bringing strangers to our home. You know what I'm saying? Like, we don't have enough food to eat enough as it is. What am I going to do here? Qui-Gon could be like, no, excuse us, you know, we don't have to stay, you know, we don't have to eat, you know, we just want a little time out of the sandstorm. And she said, and then, you know, maybe she'll change her mind, like, she'll be like, nonsense. You know, if you're going to be in my home, you might as well eat. Something like that would have been nice, you know what I'm saying? Instead of like, Mom, these are my friends that I just met 2 minutes ago. Let's eat. You know, she's like, okay, Annie. You know, it was just like, ah, come on, dude. Come on, George. Like, come on, man. Have a little bit of balls, dude. The original trilogy felt real. Real life situations, real life stuff happening in a galaxy far, far away. Right there, that felt like Full House, dude. Like, I'm watching Full House. And also, in regards to continuity, there's criticisms about why Obi-Wan didn't recognize the droids. I mean, sure, there's a million and one droids that look like C-3PO and R2-D2. But my concern is not for C-3PO because his memory got erased anyway. But R2-D2's memory is intact. And maybe Obi-Wan Kenobi didn't want to say anything because Why didn't R2-D2 say, hey, I know you. You're Obi-Wan Kenobi. We've been on a million and one adventures together. And maybe R2 did say that. You know, of course, see, this is the problem when you do a prequel. Of course, when I say this, you're retconning it in your own mind. It's none of this is in the fucking movie at all. But you could just say that Obi-Wan Kenobi, since he is not truthful, you know, he's not very forthcoming in A New Hope or Empire Strikes Back, and was in fact lying to Luke, maybe he was, you know, denying, telling a lie of omission. And maybe he didn't want to say, I know this droid, in order to get Luke on his journey. I don't know. Of course, like I said, I'm retconning it in my mind, and that's not good at all. And I think George Lucas wrote himself into a corner. But you can also give Obi-Wan the benefit of the doubt because he's not really forthcoming, like I said. And maybe he's like Merlin. Like the way Merlin was depicted in the film Labyrinth. He's like a trickster, you know what I mean? Even though he's manipulating events and giving our characters motivations to move forward, he is somewhat of a manipulator and kind of a trickster. So make of that of what you will. Now, some people have also levied criticisms in regards to why the Jedi all dressed the same. Why are they wearing the same robes that Obi-Wan Kenobi was wearing in A New Hope, and that was never the intention, and that was somehow a stupid, silly, artistic choice that George Lucas made that kind of ruined some kind of continuity that was there. But, to be fair, there's some kind of a canon Wikipedia book out there or something like that, and it says that the Jedi, they wear the robes, and the Jedi robes are indistinguishable from the simple robes that many species throughout the Star Wars galaxy wear, and that they do this because it signifies the pledge to be of service and to protect even the most humble citizen of the Republic. So that's the reason why. I'm probably 100% sure that that was retcon in there just for that. But again, you know, it's a reason. And to me, it's a total nitpick. When I saw this film the first 10 times, I wasn't like, oh, why is Qui-Gon Jinn and Obi-Wan Kenobi wearing the same robes as Obi-Wan Kenobi in A New Hope? Obi-Wan Kenobi was wearing those because he lived in the desert. Man, this film is terrible. Like, I mean, it's such a nitpick, in my opinion. And, I mean, the robes look cool. I want my Jedi to wear robes like that. I want them to look like Gandalf. You know, I don't want them to be... I don't know. I just don't get what they expected. But to me, it's a total nitpick and not a big deal to me at all. Now we need to talk about a plot point that goes absolutely nowhere. And this is involving some kind of explosive device that's been implanted in the slaves on Tatooine. When they have the meal in Anakin's home, he says that if you try to escape the planet, they have a transmitter somewhere in their bodies or in their skulls, and if you try to leave, they blow you up, is what he says. So basically, that whole plot point, or that whole little point was made, and when Qui-Gon frees the boy, it just like never gets brought up ever again. I mean, like, what the fuck, man? It's like Anakin doesn't even know where it is. Like, I think he said, yeah, that's what he said. He says, I'm working on a locator to scan for mine or something like that. So then it's like, and then if you leave the planet, it blows you up. Well, it sounds like that's a serious thing that needs to be addressed. Like, first, he has to find out where it is. And then second of all, he has to remove it. And if he can't find it with his own two eyes, then that means that it's somewhere, you know, it's somewhere ambiguous, you know, and maybe lodged somewhere deep inside your body. I felt like that should have been addressed. It was foolish. It was totally foolish to lay that plot point down and not do anything about it, George. Come on, man, dude. You should have had a scene where Watto takes the damn thing out. If you're going to mention it, follow through on it, dude. Okay, so finally, let's talk about midichlorians. As I said earlier, I like the way that George Lucas used the whole pod race sequence to exemplify how strong Anakin was in the Force. I felt like that was great. In fact, I felt like that was all he really needed. You know, he didn't really need the whole midichlorians thing. Like, I'm not against the idea of midichlorians. But what I didn't like was the quantifying of it. Being like, oh, you have 105,671 midichlorians. I mean, that was just, I feel like that's absurd, dude. But I'm not against the fact that science in this galaxy discovered that the midichlorians indeed help open up a vessel between, you know, the biological world and the spiritual world, or something like that, whatever. But to quantify the thing, to say that this boy has more midichlorians than Yoda, I mean, it's stupid, because like midichlorians are based off mitochondria, so that's like saying, oh, you know, Anakin has way more mitochondria than Anakin, you know, and or something like that. And it's just like, what? It's just like, I don't know, it's absurd, you know. It's like trying to turn it into a video game, you know, like leveling up, like I'm playing Final Fantasy, you know, and Anakin is at level 99 and he's the most powerful one, and Yoda's at level 97. It's like, oh my god, you know. It's just like, ah, dude, it kind of cheapens it. Again, I'm not against the idea of midichlorians. I actually like the idea, but to quantify it is ridiculous. You know, I feel like everyone has midichlorians, and it shouldn't be the number of midichlorians that influence how strong you are in the Force. It should be that everyone, every living thing has midichlorians, and some people are just stronger in the Force. You know, leave that part mysterious. Leave that part unexplained. Don't be like, it's because he has more mitochondria than me. You know, he has more skin cells than me. That gives him superhuman strength. You know, it's like, dude, it's bad science, dude. And, I mean, even though it's Star Wars and it's always been bad science, defying the laws of physics, I just feel like, to me, it's just too far of a stretch for me to wrap my mind around. And I just didn't like it. Again, I'm not against the idea. I think it's cool that the midichlorians act as a vessel, you know what I'm saying, between the Force, you know, and the living things. That's a cool little concept, you know, but again, quantifying it sucked. Shmi is a great character. I thought that the actress that acted her did a very good job at portraying her as a caring and loving, yet troubled and worried mother. I really liked her performance, and I really believed it. Seeing her and Qui-Gon together, it's a great scene. It makes me feel like these two would have been great parents to Anakin. I hate Anakin's friends, man, and the acting was awful. It felt forced. Maybe it's not the kids. Maybe it's not the screenplay, but whatever it is, man, it just felt like it was shot in one take, and I could tell that there's a lot of ADR going on there with the audio, and it's just a very awkward scene. And I'm specifically talking about the scene where Anakin's friends tease him for trying to race in the pod race. Oh man, it was cringeworthy, man. It was cringeworthy, man. Just the way that the whole thing, we're gonna go play ball, Anakin. Have fun with your stupid pod. Ha ha ha! It was just, oh my god. It was awful. Not to mention Kidster's stupid little lingos, man. Like, oh, that was wizard, Anakin. Dude. Oh, man. That was just weird. Kidster was a little lame in this movie. I just want to give a little shout out to Troy Denning's book, Tatooine Ghost, which is a beautiful book about Leia discovering the past. Specifically, discovering about her father's past and where her father grew up and the things that he went through when he was a young slave boy on Tatooine. And Kidster plays a big part in that story, an older Kidster. And I thought it was one of my favorite Star Wars books. It's a beautiful book, a beautiful story, and Leia comes to terms with the realities that her father grew up with, man. And it's a beautiful book, dude. Check it out. I thought Sebulba was a good villain. I liked the way that he chastised everybody. He felt very menacing. There was good voice acting there. Liam Neeson and Jake Lloyd have very good chemistry together. And it's like a great father-son relationship. There's good chemistry between both the actors. I really enjoyed when they were on screen together. Some of the second unit footage in this film is very bad. And what I mean by second unit footage, I mean some of just like little shots, specifically just shots of like the crowd cheering when the pod race is occurring. And specifically, there's one cut where Kits their high fives the little Greedo kid, and he tries to high five the kid and he fucking misses, right? He misses, and then there's this awkward look between the two, and then Greedo does this corny little dance, dude. I mean, I watched that and I'm just like, what the hell? Like, that was just like one take that was a failure, and they threw it in there, man, because that's probably all they had to do. That's all they had to work with, dude. I mean, Jesus, man. There's just little things like that to just annoy me in this film. And again, this film needed some real editing work done to it. You could have chopped off 20 minutes of exposition and little silly stuff like that, and you would have had an excellent movie. I believe that there is hints of brilliance in Phantom Menace, and there is a good movie in there somewhere, but that it's just sandwiched between all this nonsense. Now, some people didn't like the fact that the aliens, for the most part in this film, aside from Sebulba, I think, speak English, you know, and they feel like this kind of cheapens the world of Star Wars. But to that I say, Yoda. Yoda spoke English, man, and no one said nothing back then. So don't say anything now and get mad because aliens and Star Wars are speaking English for the most part. It just sounds ridiculous, in my opinion. Now, moving on, I thought the scene between Anakin and his mother when he says goodbye to her was very touching. Again, John Williams' soundtrack is just astounding. It's my favorite one, episode one, and I particularly love Anakin's theme. It's beautiful music, man. Such beautiful compositions. Again, the scene is just beautiful. It's sweet, it's innocent, and I really appreciate it. I love the Qui-Gon versus Darth Maul sequence. It was badass. Short but sweet, and leaves you drooling and craving for more. It was great. And I wish that they had kept the deleted scene of Qui-Gon destroying the probe droid. And the deleted scenes to this film, a probe droid, the ones that Darth Maul initially sent out to scout for the princess and Qui-Gon. Qui-Gon is able to sense it and he slices it in half with his lightsaber. And I don't know, I just thought it was a nice little scene. It was exciting, a little bit of action. It would have been cool. Seeing Coruscant on the screen for the first time was a trip, especially since audiences or Star Wars fans, they read about Coruscant in books like the Thrawn trilogy. To actually see it depicted on the screen, something that we read about in the comics and in the books, was just cool, man. It was nice that George Lucas was paying attention to the books, that he wasn't just disregarding everything. Even though he did disregard many things that was laid down, especially in the Bantam era books, such as Jedi being able to have children, and the fact that the clones fought against the Jedi. I actually love the scenes on Coruscant. It's actually my favorite part in the movie, and I hear lots of criticisms about that because they feel like it's boring politics. And again, I say this is one of my favorite parts in the film because it illustrates the history and the lore, and it's unfolding right before our eyes, the lore and history of the Star Wars world. So I feel like I'm right there in the middle of the Star Wars galaxy, and all this shit is hitting the fan, and I'm right there witnessing the fall of the Republic. And it was nice to see Palpatine manipulate the events into his favor. I mean, this is great stuff. And just seeing the Senate chamber and how that was conceptualized and visualized, and seeing how massive it was, and that this huge Senate chamber housed every planet in the Star Wars galaxy. It was just, it was amazing. I mean, it was space opera, dude, right there before our eyes. I can't believe that people feel like they're watching C-SPAN when they see this sequence, man. For me, this thing was enthralling. And I was very young when I saw this, man. It was not a boring scene to me. It was, you know, because I knew that something in this scene is so important. And it's going to have the ripple effects in order to bring out the events that happened in the original trilogy. So I don't understand why people felt like this was boring. I like when Palpatine was able to get rid of the old Chancellor by manipulating Padme. You could see that Palpatine was thinking on his feet. Plans weren't going according to how he wanted them to go, you know, with her signing the treaty and stuff. So he was able to, you know, perform a nice little juggling act right here and get Padme to be the one to recall the Chancellor. You know, he didn't expect that Padme would, you know, be such a badass. He thought that she would submit to the Trade Federation, but instead she wanted to fight. So instead he's like, hey, well, the Chancellor is incompetent. Call for that fool's removal. Brilliant improvisation from the face of evil, man. Darth Sidious right there. I don't know, I guess that this scene may have been too cerebral or too political for some people and felt a little bit like Star Trek for people, but I love Star Trek. And again, I felt like this was real, real, real deep stuff happening right here before our eyes. And no, it shouldn't have been juxtaposition with Jar Jar's farting and Jar Jar caca poo poo nonsense, you know what I'm saying? But again, there's some real good in this movie, and I don't want to overlook that. I enjoy how George Lucas made the politics feel real and authentic, because it makes the Star Wars universe feel more believable. And as you can see, the Republic is so corrupt that they have a corporation like the Trade Federation represented in the Senate. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine Apple having its own congresswoman or congressman, you know, in the House of Representatives? Can you imagine that? Well, it's almost like that, because some of these people are bought and some of these people do have ties to corporations. So I love how George Lucas is, you know what I'm saying, illustrating the fall of the Republic by using some of our real world examples. It also illustrates how the bureaucratic process is used to slow down progress. And I just have to say, Ian McDiarmid is a great actor. He's outstanding. I also love Padme's costumes. I mean, such great conceptualization, such great art design, such great costume design. I mean, this film has that in spades, despite its ongoing issues with tone, with silly exposition, its problems with the blocking. It's still got some brilliant artistry. Seeing the Jedi Council for the first time was a trip. The Yoda CGI puppet, oh, now that was a little awkward at first, and I much prefer the CGI revision that they did on the Blu-ray release. I really appreciate that, because I don't know, there was something off about the original Yoda puppet. And it wasn't so much its face, I just assumed that it was a younger version of Yoda and that's how he looked. What really threw me off was just the texture of his skin or the material that they used. It just looked really fake, like some shiny rubbery material. Whereas the original Yoda puppet, it looked really aged, you know what I mean? It looked withered and aged, like, you know, like a real old person. Whereas this, it looked oily and shiny. It's just something really off by that. And you know, I wish that they elaborated more on the prophecy. Like, who made the prophecy? Stuff like that. It's just very vague and very ambiguous. I guess it creates a air of mystery, but you know what I'm saying? For me, it was just too little. You know, they should have just gave us a little bit more on the backstory in regards to the prophecy. At least who made it, how long ago was it, and why is it so credible to the Jedi? And I saw, when I first saw the Jedi Temple, it was pretty amazing, because you know, we never seen just Jedi in general. We've only seen one at a time, two at a time, but boom, here we have a whole chamber of like what, 20 right there? And you know, just seeing all the different races and all the different alien species of Jedi, it was a trip. Unfortunately, the Jedi are a bunch of arrogant assholes. we all know that that plays a part in their downfall, but they truly were some arrogant assholes, and I really think that there was some missed opportunities here. Qui-Gon is more flexible and rebellious, whereas the Jedi are obviously super orthodox and super structured and super rigid. Furthermore, I think George Lucas really needed to elaborate more on the fear that Anakin has, and how this is the reason to not want to train him. They say he has too much fear because he misses his mother, but I feel like, I don't know, I mean, of course he misses his mother, man. He's 9 years old. Like, why the hell do the Jedi have such a big problem with people having feelings and people having emotions? I really, really, really have a bone to pick with this little aspect of the story.
And for me, one of the most maddening things about this element of the story is just this whole notion that people give their infant children to the Jedi and that they agree never to see their children ever again. Just the whole concept of the Jedi taking babies away from their families and forbidding them ever seeing each other ever again is just absurd to me. I understand what George Lucas is trying to do. He's trying to give this criticism about suppressing emotion and how the Jedi became too orthodox, but just the execution here, it's just absurd because I just can't believe that a galaxy filled with all these various different types of sentient beings, sentient aliens, will agree to give their children to these monks that they don't know, and agree never to see their children ever again, and vice versa. Just the whole notion that a baby is going to commit to this certain lifestyle where you can't get married, and you can't see your family, you can't have your own family, and you're making this lifelong decision as a baby is just absurd, it's ridiculous, it's excessive in its execution. I just don't believe it. And I know people that defend this element of the story, they like to bring up the Dalai Lama and the samurai. And to me, it's like, look, that is way more credible to me than the way it's executed in this film. The samurai, yes, had young apprentices and young pupils, children, whatever, but they were allowed to have relations. They were allowed to have families. And as far as the Dalai Lama, that was just one man, one person that was supposed to be like the embodiment of ultimate enlightenment. So it's not like a whole council or sect or organization filled with thousands of Dalai Lamas or thousands of Jedi. It's just one person that's supposed to be ultimately special. And the people that were involved in that giving up of their kid to be the Dalai Lama knew what the Dalai Lama was. They knew it was a privilege. But for me, just seeing this, I don't know. I just don't buy it. I just don't agree with the execution that George Lucas made. People like to bring up the whole Dalai Lama thing, but just for me, I just can't agree with that. I just don't buy the execution, at least the way it's depicted in this film. And I understand what George Lucas is trying to do, because we have to be mindful that this is a galaxy, a story filled with individuals with superhuman powers, essentially. And I understand that the Jedi have to be careful who they teach these skills to, because if they teach it to the wrong person, it can turn into something very bad. You know, they could use it for evil. So I understand there has to be this caution in who they're going to give their skills to, who are they going to teach the skills to. But it's the aspect where they don't allow people to see families, people to have families, you can't have attachment. And just thinking that a baby is going to fully commit themselves to this lifestyle, it just comes across as very disturbing, for lack of a better term. And this is one of the worst aspects of this film to me. This is where I have such huge reservations as far as this element of the story. I dislike this more than I dislike the lack of blocking, and even issues that I have with Jar Jar Binks, because this is just so, like, it just makes the whole Star Wars galaxy feel excessively sterile, and it's just unbelievable. I can never wrap my mind around this, and it's probably the number one thing that I dislike about this film, or it's right up there in the top two or three things. And another strange thing about this artistic decision in regards to this story element, it's that in the Tales of the Jedi comics, the Jedi were allowed to have families. They were allowed to have some emotions. Sure, they had to control them, but this whole ultimate suppression of emotions, as it's depicted in this film, it's just insane. It's absurd. And I guess that contributed to the Jedi's downfall. I mean, evidently it did, but it was too much. George Lucas needed to take this idea and chop it down in half, because it just looks like the Jedi ultimately are the most inhuman individuals in the galaxy. For lack of a better term, I know there's aliens and et cetera, but I'm just saying, like, it's like they're anti-emotion just altogether. It's like they, instead of being Jedi, they feel more like Vulcans, like from Star Trek. And I don't particularly like that. I mean, as much good as there is in this film, this is one thing that I can never get over. Maybe it's because I grew up to those Tales of the Jedi comics and the Jedi were, like, normal, you know what I mean? It's like, it's okay to have emotions, you just have to control them, but here the Jedi are just anti-emotion, no emotion, you can't have any, none, and that is just unrealistic, and I can see how what George Lucas was going for and how this would play into the downfall of the Jedi, but I mean, I just really dislike this aspect of the story. I feel like it would have been so much better if instead of saying to Anakin that, or to Qui-Gon Jinn in regarding Anakin, instead of saying he's too old, they could have said he has developed too much of an attachment to his mother. He's dangerous to train. Then you could get the same idea executed, but in a more believable way, in my opinion. But to outright say, he's too old. Anybody over 2 months old is too old to be a Jedi. It's like, ah, come on, man. I really hate this aspect of the story, but I digress.
And also, the setting up of the Queen's plan to retake Naboo took forever. Man, it's so boring and way too much exposition, especially after the scenes on Coruscant. We had these scenes on Coruscant that were important and interesting to me, even though it was all dialogue. And boom, we get back to Naboo and guess what? More dialogue, more standing around, setting up the fight to take back the City of Thieves. It's like, sheesh, just take it back. You gotta cut the exposition, man. It drags the film down immensely. And the battle, it needs to be set up faster. Just like the pod race, it needed to be set up faster. And the blocking is so bad here. Especially where Obi-Wan is apologizing to Qui-Gon for questioning back on Coruscant. It's terrible. He's just standing around, staring into nothing, dude. Literally. And again, I wanted to see Darth Maul doing more hunting and more stalking. And the Jar Jar scenes are really, really fucking annoying and not funny. Falling around and all that. The little Padme twist, having her be both Queen Amidala and Padme, it wasn't really that surprising, because we as the audience knew that Natalie Portman was the actor for both of them. So it really wasn't that surprising that she was the Queen and Padme at the same time. I really liked the Gungan march against the battle droids. It was very impressive at its time, and it very much reminded me of like the story War and Peace. I really appreciated that. The ending was good. However, I feel that they shouldn't have the Jar Jar jokes. It totally disrupted some of the tension in those scenes, man. The Duel of Fates. They already had me going out for a stretch for all the stuff with Anakin since he's a kid and he's in a starfighter. So they were already appealing to the little kids right there, you know what I'm saying? So you didn't need all that Jar Jar, Buster Douglas, fumbling, falling around humor. It's just overkill, man. They didn't need it. But I do love a lot of scenes, especially when Padme and Panaka use their grappling hook cables and, dude, the Duel of Fates, man. Literally the greatest battle in Star Wars, arguably. Beautiful music, beautiful choreography, beautiful direction, beautiful compositions. This is where George Lucas shined right here, man. I love the compositions of this fight. How, you know, we go from wide angles, seeing Darth Maul fighting Qui-Gon on a high platform from far away, from Obi-Wan's point of view, to a low angle shot of Qui-Gon fighting Darth Maul in that little energy chamber or whatever it was. It's brilliant. This sequence is brilliant. I really, really love it. This is brilliant. You know, I cannot say that enough. And again, this feeling that this scene gives me is so intense. This Duel of Fates feels like almost like some kind of like religious event is going on. You know what I'm saying? Like you're seeing the angel Michael fight against the devil himself or something. You know what I mean? I really loved it. Great sequence. I really have to lean positive for this movie, just slightly, because this film is the movie that gave me what I love the most, and that is the Sith. I love the lore of the Sith. It's my favorite aspect of Star Wars. I love Darth Maul's double-bladed lightsaber and the Rule of Two and seeing how the Sith manipulate behind the scenes. It's great. I love all this Jedi lore. And this film really introduced this level of mystique and mystery to everything. And I used to sit there as a young guy and just wonder so much about the Sith and the tales of the Jedi and what was to come, despite all the negative aspects of this film. The film cracked open a huge can of worms for me, and I really started wondering about the past and history of the Star Wars saga. It made it into a huge universe for me. I love the ending because the villain wins. That is something that separates this film from the others. And I love how the movie ends and you think that the good guys won. You think that they won the day. But you sit there and you see Palpatine just with the little grin on his face, you know what I mean? You just see them as there's that rack focus during the funeral pyre with Qui-Gon. You know, there's that rack focus when Mace Windu and Yoda talk about the Sith and how there can only be two. Which one was killed, the master or the apprentice? And then it just rack focuses to Palpatine, you know, right there indicating that he's the master. He's Sidious, duality. And there we have our little parade at the end. The good guys won. But Sidious Palpatine is Chancellor now. So who really won? Brilliant ending. Brilliant. And that's what I'm talking about. See? That's George Lucas doing something brilliant. Great idea. George Lucas with the whole Jedi and the kids thing? Terrible idea. It's like a film of two extremes, man. The Phantom Menace. But coming back to Sidious and Palpatine winning at the end of this film and having it look like the good guys won. If you listen to the soundtrack, if you listen to John Williams' soundtrack in this particular scene where everyone's celebrating, that theme that sounds so happy and jolly is actually the Emperor's theme played at a different note. You know, it's like the theme, you know, everybody knows the Emperor's theme was like dun na na dun na na dun na 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 na. And then what's the theme of Phantom Menace? Da 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 da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You know, it's just like, what? It's just a small little nuance in there, and I love it. So there you have it, guys. That's my analysis and review of The Phantom Menace. Again, it's a film of two extremes. You have some really brilliant ideas, and you have some really absurd and abhorrent ideas coming together in an eclectic mix of filmmaking, you know what I mean? And people have a love-hate relationship with this movie. I do. And I just have to say, there is a reason why we keep coming back to this film. Because again, there's some hints of brilliance in it, and it's that we appreciate. I appreciate it. Again, some of those hints of brilliance are in the visualization and the conceptualization of like the action sequences, the pod race, the duel of fates, John Williams's music, Liam Neeson, the art direction, the costume design, Darth Maul, having the Emperor return, Ian McDiarmid, his whole plot, the whole little twist that he's the one that actually won at the end, even though it looks like the good guys won, the themes of symbiosis and duality. Yet, at the same time, the film has terrible, terrible, terrible blocking. The film has a weak tone that's all over the place. The tone is wacky. It goes from being slapstick comedy to serious to political. The tone was really off. And also just the whole conceptualization of how the Jedi are inducted into the Jedi religion, you know, taking kids and just having them not be able to see their families and not even being able to have emotions, like missing your mother. I mean, I just abhor that idea. I hate it. And another, too much exposition. 20 minutes could have been cut into this film, man. And those things really make this film suffer. Big time. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed the analysis, and if you did, please like, and last but not least, you know, may the force be with you. One love.